Thank you so much for being here. This is like the end of the conference, and I know your brains are full and you're on overload, and so you're going to bear with me. I'm going to put a timer, because if I don't, you know what will happen. I'll just keep going. And to be honest, this is the first time I've ever presented about HyperDocs to a group larger than 30. And that's important to note, because I never present about HyperDocs without putting y'all on the HyperDoc, because best way to learn is through doing. Now, come to find out, you can't put that many people on a Google Doc and get y'all interactively working. So I wanted to, we're just gonna give each other a break, right? I'll give you sort of a brain break, a little bit, maybe. And you'll give me a break because I have slides. That's weird for me. So forgive me. I'm going to show you some slides. Now, I have some important links up here. The first one, Learn HyperDocs, is the actual workshop that if we were together in a room, I love about 20 of us together at once, that's the workshop that I give. Now, on there is a link to a webinar. So you can always take that webinar and share it with other people. Who want to know, what are HyperDocs? I don't get this. Because sometimes it takes a little more explaining. This will also be videotaped, though, as well. The one on the right, I'm sorry, for your your right, is HyperDocs Home. That is my personal website. And I'm going to jump out of the slides, and I have to go to the website, and I'll be kind of going through there. You know, guys, I'm a teacher, and I don't have time to make fancy websites, right? Who has time for that? It's kind of like my bulletin board. I just keep dumping good things on there when I find them. And so it's kind of mismatched and misordered. We are in the process of getting ourselves together, though, because so many people want good information, and you deserve to have it in an organized way. These links will be changing. And so on both locations, everywhere I'll post it, our new website is coming really soon. We're in the middle of making it right now, where it will be much more organized for you to find some things. So I just want to see a show of hands. How many of you have heard of HyperDocs? Oh, so awesome. How many of you are using HyperDocs? Great, this is really exciting. All right, that's good for me to know. There was a few years ago where I was here and I brought it up and nobody had known about it. Well, these are my two coworkers, Kelly Hilton and Sarah Landis, and they are also the brilliance behind HyperDocs. The three of us work together. We used to all be fifth grade teachers, and now we're instructional coaches. And we were tasked in our district to come up with, oh, and please give them a follow and a shout out, because I'm sorry that they're not here with me today. They're absolutely brilliant with the work that's behind creating HyperDocs. We had a challenge to do, and I really can't stand my face being up there that long, so I have to take it off. our schools were getting all of these Chromebooks. And we're like, yes, we're getting technology for testing. Like, are you kidding me? We finally get the technology we've been wanting, and now it's for testing. Oh, we see what is the motivation here. Well, and then the principals were like, so teachers, I want you to use them also to teach the kids how to type. And you know, they really didn't know to word process and to write your papers. And people didn't really know what to do when these carts were being pushed into their classrooms. And so what we needed to do was come up with a way. You know, our job was to train teachers to adopt new Common Core curriculum and new ELA and new math curriculum. And I was the instructional technology coach. And we kind of wanted this miracle of all miracle answers. Not only did we want to teach teachers how to use technology, that was about this much of it. We wanted to help teachers become better teachers. We wanted to shift the way they were instructing. And we thought, what a better time as right now. We'll just use Common Core as the excuse. you know, this is the time, it's the wave, it's the change. And so we created the word. We made it up. I know it's like a lot of people are like, I hate the name. But you know, it stuck. And so it's actually, we trademarked it. We're so excited that a name that we made up is now trademarked. But you need to know a little more about what it is. And in order to do that, you have to understand where I'm coming from with this whole talk. I know you're at a tech conference, but I'm really here to talk to you just about teaching. This whole session is about good teaching. And this technology in HyperDocs helped me to become a better teacher. And that was our mission. We wanted teachers to become a better teacher and make it easier for them. Because I'll tell you something, this is my manifesto. This is my mantra. This is what I have to do. These are all the things. Do you relate to this list? Yeah, this is like, yeah, I had to do all that. Yeah, at once while you're maintaining, you know, you could go on. Wouldn't you add to this? And I've got 30 kids and I've got, you know, whatever, how many, or 180 students. It seems overwhelming, correct? Yeah. Am I giving you like a little stress right now? Sorry, it'll get better. I know what's on your plate. I do. I'm a teacher. I understand that. And a lot of times I felt like I was juggling because I had, you know, I've got my PTA meetings and I've got my tech committee and I've got my other committee I'm on and I'm writing the school site plan and everything seemed to be in its own little pile. And every time they added something new, I added something to my plate. Yes, do you agree? You feel that way? You guys, you've been seeing the plate the wrong way. Instead of thinking, you know, we say, oh, we should have a growth mindset. Here it comes. You don't want to hear it always, but instead of seeing it as you're adding something to my plate, why aren't we seeing it like this? How can I work smarter and blend this all together and do this instruction in a way that meets that huge manifesto I showed, plus all the extras, and at the same time made me a happy person and love the job and the craft. I don't even want to say job, right? How many of you are like, no, I love my job. I got into teaching because I was called into teaching. I was. I have a passion for it. It is my craft. How many of you miss that, though? Yeah, you miss that. And so we wanted HyperDocs to answer that question also. We wanted to take that on for you. Because honestly, folks, I am standing here in front of you, but this is all that matters to me. This is my favorite spot in the classroom, reading to them. Extra credit if you know what book that is. Oh yeah, you all knew. It was Wonder. And they're really happy. I'm not saying that they're not happy, right? They just were like, would you just read the book? Stop taking pictures of us. But I need you to answer a really important question. And again, I'm going to touch on a touchy subject. I need you to answer honestly, not out loud. Don't turn and talk. This is personal. How are you maximizing FaceTime in your classroom? FaceTime with them. So the kids are there, you have a limited amount of time with them. We never have enough time, do we? How are you maximizing that time to do exactly what you want to do at the very best level you could do it? And I want you to also ask yourself, what's stealing your time? Because I always talk to teachers and they're like, well, I have to do this, and I have to do this, and I have to do this. I'm like, do you love doing that? And they're like, oh my God, I just hate that. I'm like, then why are you doing that? Well, we're told to do that. Oh, and the police are like standing there at your door. Why don't you try something different? Why don't you do it differently? Why don't you weave it in a different way? I'll get deeper in this. You're like, yeah, right. So this is where our idea came from. Why am I doing all the work? And it just seems like more and more work on me. And they're sitting there going, yeah, just give me the packet and I'll fill it out and tell me what to do. Our big aha was to create the HyperDoc, an interactive Google Doc that replaces the worksheet or lecture method of delivering instruction. Now, there's a lot to that idea, and I'll have a lot of examples to share with you. This is an example of a HyperDoc. It is a Google Doc. I added color, I made it look nice. You know what, even upper grade, people like to see things that look nice. It doesn't always have to be a white page. There were clear expectations set at the beginning. This one actually has collaborative groups can access their projects through links. And I curated all the resources for that actual project on one page. My actual lesson was not how to do a Google search. My actual lesson was to get those presentations done. So why not you pull your resources together in an organized manner? With a shortened link, I can send this out to students and say, get to work. I put you into your groups. Now, do I need one-to-one Chromebooks? No, I don't necessarily want one-to-one Chromebooks. I actually want them working in groups. I want one per table group, because then they have to talk to each other, and they have to negotiate, and they have to divide up. It works really well that way. I mean, there's times when I want all hands on deck, but not always. See, HyperDocs are about packaging. Think about how you're packaging your lessons. Are you standing up front and just throwing it out there and then quickly writing a link on the board that they have to then type in? Oh, that's the worst, especially if you are teaching elementary school. It's a nightmare. You'll never make it through below third grade. And I'm sure upper grades too. Writing down URLs is a nightmare. I will never write down a URL except to launch the HyperDoc. You want them to look good because no one wants to go, oh, really, this is what we're doing today? I want kids to walk into my classroom and go, oh my gosh, what are we doing today? You know, and well, they don't act like that. They don't say it like that. They're kind of like, well, what's happening today? You know, they're like all shy about it. You know they want to know. It's organized, so there's not all these papers stuffed in their backpack where they can't find them. It's all in one place, always. And it's accessed from any device, whether it's at home, not that I require it ever at home, but it's they can access it anytime they want. It builds inquiry learning, and the most important to me, it inspires curiosity. I want kids to be curious, so it leaps from one activity to another sometimes. And it's alive. You know, my lessons, they'll flop in the middle, and I'll go home and change them so that it will be different the next day on the same HyperDoc. This is my goal. Create inquiry-based lessons which enable students to learn through exploration of a topic. The lecture, it doesn't work. They're not listening to you. I hope you're listening to me. Okay. Listen to me for just now, but then, you know. Like I said, I would have been letting you explore this. I meant to, but, you know, I'm so happy you're all here. So let me give you some examples. This is AP World History Summer Project Requirements. Woohoo! Aren't you excited? Yeah. What's the first thing you look for? The due date. When's it due? What do I have to do? Right? How much work is there? What if you repackaged it to look like that? It's the same thing. And you treated people like adults. If they're going to do reading, then put the cover of the book and give a link to the Amazon review of the book. And then over the summer, give them a place where they can collaborate together and talk to each other so they're not little islands at home. You know what? They might actually read it before the last week of school. Now, this is a really simple one. It's just a table. It's just a couple of links. It's not too in-depth. You haven't started with them yet. And that's where some criticism comes in of HyperDocs. I've been hearing some news that some people are saying it's just a doc with links. Substitution. You need to think about that when you say that, because You're the creator of the HyperDoc. You have the control over what it is. You make it what it is. So yes, it could be just a document with links on it, but it's not supposed to be. And it could be more. Now, that's not to say that I don't make some HyperDocs that just have a bunch of links, because I do, but it always leads to something more. See, HyperDocs are based on lesson design, good lesson design, a changed lesson design. And I'm giving you some hints from the book. This is a sneak peek. Never been seen. This is one of our main templates. And it's a different cycle of learning. See, when I went to school, the cycle of learning, actually, I'm not all excuses. I'm sorry, I'm going to be totally honest. When I started teaching, the cycle of learning I did in the classroom, explain, apply, assess. I lecture, I give you homework, I test you to see if you knew the content. Now, if you just would shake up that cycle of learning and change it around, do you see where explain is now on the template? It's down much further. You engage first, then you let kids explore a content, see what they know, see what they bring to it, see what they don't know, and then you adjust their schema, you explain, and then they apply the knowledge. And so often, I know that way back, you've been always told they should share and reflect, right? And we never have time for that. You are missing the best part of the cake, the icing. And it's sort of like not actually giving the fork with the cake, because it's not going to stick. Nothing's going to stick if you don't reflect on that learning. That is such a crucial part of this. Now, when you first start making HyperDocs, this is a really easy way to start. It reminds you to include these pieces to a good lesson design. And sometimes I'm just letting you explore a list of links. So if you see a HyperDoc that's a list of links, you're like, yeah, that's just one little piece of the actual lesson. That's just today. It's going to extend the next day. But I can't put all of that on one document for a kid. Are you kidding? They like freak out. They're like, it's too much work. I can't do it. Right? I mean, let's be real. HyperDocs have, and I know I hate to throw these out here, but I'm going to do this pretty quick. And I really mean this, though. I live by this. This helps me a lot. I actually, every time I create one, I think about the four C's, and they're really crucial. I ask myself, am I getting kids to communicate? Are they sharing their thoughts or questions? Are they collaborating in any way? Are they working together? Can I get kids to work together? And sometimes that means leaving the HyperDoc and looking at each other and talking to each other and closing all technology and using paper, pencil. And that's okay. It's that ebb and flow. HyperDocs are all about the blended learning with that. This is so important to me, the critical thinking. Are they looking at problems in a new way? Are you going across disciplines? And the creativity. And when I look at this piece, this is kind of like my, yes, it's a HyperDoc, is are you creating? So what that you just learned that? Now what are you going to do with it? This is kind of like at the end, I say, well, it's almost a HyperDoc, but you didn't really make anything. You didn't really do anything. You didn't really apply the knowledge. The creating part, I know creativity is like being creative, but really to me that is create, apply that new knowledge you have. See, because sometimes these all sound like just rhetoric, more to add to that plate, right? I think I had those on the manifesto. But these are important to consider. I mean, people really thought a long time about these. They're brilliant about what it is. And so the HyperDoc girls and I, we thought that we need to bring these together. We need to bring SAMR together with Webb's depth of knowledge, which is really the critical thinking piece. And the SAMR piece is, to what level are we taking our lessons? Are we using technology as enhancement? Are we transforming learning with this technology? Because if not, maybe we don't need it. Maybe we don't need to use it. But this gets so confusing. You're like, oh, wait, is that a DOK2 and a modification and, you know, checkmate? You know, I just can't even make sense. Now, as much as I would love to share with you the new, we have a rubric that we've created. I deleted it an hour ago. I couldn't do it. It's coming out in June in the book. We've created, I know you're like, whatever, I'm leaving. Teaser. I know there's something else to come though, but we created a rubric that includes both SAMR and Webb's depth of knowledge and the four C's in one rubric. It's sort of like a checklist. And you can look at your HyperDoc and say, am I on the right track with this? Well, we do have something on our website that is sort of like that. We've taken HyperDocs we've created, and we filtered them in under substitution, augmentation, modification, and redefinition. So you could see mentor text, so you can understand what that might look like. What does a HyperDoc look like at substitution level? Are you dying to see the redefinition ones? Yeah, I'm sorry, I'm not gonna show them all to you again. But I do want you to know that we put so much thinking into this about these levels, and we take them very seriously. So when people say it's just a Google Doc with a bunch of links, can you see how I'm like, oh no, it's way more than that. Because you can make it way more than that. But I have to say, no, I don't have my glasses on here. Oh, I can read it up here. It's large. Lesson in the substitution. This is such an important thing to like seriously give yourself a break. If you make a HyperDoc and you're feeling like it's substitution, lesson is teaching foundational skills that will lead to more complex skills. We cannot start our second graders off with a redefinition lesson. You start off with substitution and you build skills and you keep going until they're ready for that level. All right, I'd like to share with you my first HyperDoc. I was at a talk, and this is not the YouTube session, so I'm not going to play this video because it's going to make you cry. I loved it, and I'm like, oh, I got to make a lesson about that video. And so it was about the Sobri, and he's lost his way in India on the train, and he can't find his mother. It's just a beautiful video. And I really wanted kids, and he found his way home using Google Maps. And I wanted the kids to experience that video and to find their special place in the world. And so I wrote this up, and look, I even have a raw link. A raw link means it's like you can actually see the URL. You could tell it's my first there. And so I let them explore Google Maps and find their special place in the world. And then I started part one. Now there's my instructions, we're on the document. As the kids scrolled through here and they knew what to do, think about a place you wanna see. And I put a graphic organizer on here because these little tables in the middle of your HyperDoc are just amazing. Like they're all of a sudden like, oh, I know what to write. But if it was a blank page, they have no idea what to write. And as you keep scrolling, there are some samples. I put mentor samples. And then, so far in this activity, it was pretty substitution. Did I need technology for this? Absolutely not. I could have done this in their writer's notebooks. Actually, a lot of times I just do it in their writer's notebooks. We don't need to do it on the devices. I can just show the video in class, and everyone just write a story about your special place. I did my job. Check it off. Check that standard off. But then you start thinking about those four C's. Are they collaborating? Are they communicating with each other? Did they create anything? Are they thinking critically? And here comes some work, part two. I'm like, I gotta keep going. So I'm like, I added part two. So we made a class map of the best places on the planet. And I didn't wanna teach them how to do the map. So I put the seven steps there. I'm all, here you go, guys, get to work. Figure it out. They're like, what? You're not gonna lecture us on how to do it step by step? I'm like, no, I just wanna see if they could figure it out on their own. Critical thinking. How can you get kids to be critical thinkers when you're doing all the thinking for them? You're not asking them to think critically, you're telling them step by step how to do something. Step back and then like pretend like, oh, I don't know how to do it, I don't know. Can you show me when you figure it out? And they're like, whatever. So here's what they came up with. Places to love, and they all put their happy place in the world on here. And it was amazing. Talk about taking writer's workshop. Oops, they did write on that one. Watch, I'm gonna pick all the ones they didn't write. Oh, my friend's house. Oh, sledding in Tahoe. Right? You could tell your story of that time. I think there's a John, he went to Washington, D.C. Did you know that? Oh, my fifth grade house, I was telling him about that. Chloe's cousin's wedding. You wanted to know about her wedding, didn't you? But I'll tell you something. You know what happened when they got this map? They were all into themselves. You know, kids are all into themselves in my story. But the minute they finished, I didn't have to give this instruction. All of a sudden, I'm like, hey, what are you doing? Are you looking at other people's pins? Ah, you're curious. And I didn't have to go one at a time, stand up and tell me your special place, my special place in the world, and listen to it 30 times and bang your head on the desk. Like, oh my God, after like 10, I'm like, why did I do this project? I don't care about your special place. I'm bad. I have the attention span of a squirrel. And so why am I wasting face time with my students doing that either? I mean, what am I thinking? And so they explore it. You look at it on your own. And then your FaceTime with kids is totally different. You say, hey, what did you discover about your classmates? Is anyone having something in common in here? Do you see how I took that critical thinking, that questioning, all of a sudden elevated instantly in the classroom? Now, I've tried to skip this step many times. I thought, oh, to speed it up, I have content to cover. I have European exploration to get to. Oh yeah, don't ever skip that first step. I'm not kidding you. Because when you're trying to teach about the explorers, guess where they're all at? They're at their house on the map. I heard someone say that over there. They're not over in Spain looking where Cabral left from. You know, they just want to know about themselves. Once they get that out of their system, they're fine. But everyone's giving me grief, like, I need content, all right? So go, look, part three. I added this on later. And just to make my worksheet loving friends that I was getting grief from happy, I took the worksheet and put it on here. Does that look familiar? Explorer name, dates of exploration, sailed from, sailed to. Oh, I hate that work. So, but I still did it. To say that I did it, and there's the link to the research, so you're not off wasting time finding that research, but I'm going to get to the important part. Now explore the routes of the three explorers using Google Maps. Like, why are we not using maps to actually get on there and actually look at the route they went on a Google Map? Doesn't that make sense? Like, take a step back and look at your curriculum and go, what am I doing? What is the point? What do I want them? I want them to be curious about these explorers. Do you know how frightening it would be to say, I'm going to take the shortcut through this strait down at the bottom of South America? Like, we talk about the Straits of Magellan, but do you know how frightening that would be to take that little shortcut through there? And I asked the kids, well, why didn't they just keep going? That became like our essential question for the rest of the unit. And the kids posted their ahas here. We went back in and did a map again. No more boring explorer reports. They put all their knowledge here. Are you wondering about the skull? Oh yeah, so was I. I'm like, I feel a digital citizenship lesson coming. I did. I'm all, why did you do that? Oh, Henry Hudson died here in a small boat, along with his son and seven crew members due to mutiny. Like, they're 10, and they're putting their content there. Do I need a textbook? No. Do the kids need the textbook? They just created the text. Student-created content. And guess what? I have never seen kids gobble up European exploration more than this assignment. They were checking everybody's posts. And then the starting line in the classroom, the conversation, the FaceTime. The craft that I bring is the discussion, the questioning, those higher level thinking skills. I had time for it because I wasn't like, okay, and then this explorer went here, and I wasn't just spouting information. I was saying, what patterns did you notice between the different explorers? Was there a popular route? What tips did they need so they weren't being killed? And they were answering these much, much more complex questions. Do you see how that very first lesson went, going through three parts, went through those SAMR levels, how it went through those DOK levels and the four C's? All right, I'm sorry, that was a diversion there. I gotta get back on track here. I tell you, that first HyperDoc, sometimes it's the first one that can exemplify what you're trying to do. The best part is, I didn't have to go to the copy machine. It didn't cost me anything. I love that. My copy budget is zero. Now, sometimes I need to build background knowledge, and I use multimedia text sets. And so this is sometimes where they get that, you know, oh, it's a bunch of links. Instead of you lecturing, and I highly encourage you, if you want to get started doing this, take a Google Doc, make a table, put all your content in the table, and have an expectation for them exploring that content. Just start there, and it is, oh, you will really be hooked after this. But do note, what part of the lesson design is this? This is the explore part. This is where you're building background knowledge. And then you start these discussions in class and you're like, ooh, you guys missed it. You didn't get the gist of what I wanted you to get. I'm gonna fill that in. I'm gonna lecture you today. Sometimes a good lecture is just so awesome, right? It is. You're the best storytellers, and don't stop doing that. But you just don't have to do it all the time. Let them explore it in any order they want. Let them go back to it as many times as they want. Now, I'm gonna start showing you some HyperDocs and some different purposes to them. I'm gonna start going kind of fast through these because there's so many I wanna show you. But if there's science teachers in the room, do you recognize this lesson plan format? Ooh, did I say lesson plan? I mean lesson design. Because I know you do not fill out lesson plans, right? This is the, I'm counting. It's the five E's. I'm not a science teacher. I apologize. I'm like, it's the five E's lesson design. And you can create your own HyperDoc using that same template. This is a really amazing HyperDoc that Kelly made, actually. By packaging all there, it was for upper grades. Imagine handing that out instead of that white sheet of paper that I showed you earlier. All the links are there, all the resources are there, including the discussions. Now, it's what you put in those links that makes it rich in depth and authenticity and makes it real. Okay, I'm going younger now. And this is a different lesson format. This is my explore, explain, apply. And it's one of my favorite lessons because it's blended learning as well. As we were doing my favorite book, I wanted kids to collaborate and share their thinking. Well, then I showed them a video about a little girl with Treacher-Collins syndrome, which is the same as what Augie has in the book. And it's really not something I would post for kids to watch over and over again. It's hard to watch. The little girl is it's a really hard birth disorder. So I wanted them to turn and talk. It was not something that was needed for tech. It was something to do face-to-face together. And then I wanted them to create posters using Canva. There's the apply your knowledge. What would you say to others to treat them kindly? It was really simple activity, engaging. Sometimes I want their response for something challenging like poetry analysis. Okay, I want you to think about, for whatever we lose, like a you or a me, it's always ourselves we find in the sea. That was fifth grade poetry analysis. If you don't give them hard things to analyze, they're not going to give you high-level thinking. Give them something way harder than they think they're capable of and just see what they're gonna put on there. It is unbelievable what kids will say when you just open up the opportunity to say it. And think about this, how many quiet kids are in your class? And if you know that term, quiet, And you've seen the TED Talk Quiet or read the book Quiet. This is so important. Every child in your classroom deserves to be heard. Every child has something to say. Every student wants to say something, but are we listening in the right way? They're not going to raise their hand. They're not going to be like, oh, call on me. They leave that to the five that do that every day. But they have just as much to share, and we're not hearing them. So post a link to a Padlet or anything to let them get their word out and let their classmates hear them in a way that is so powerful and can really change the life of that quiet child. If you do it for anybody, do it for those kids. You know, on top of that too, do it for yourself. The kids would leave the at the end of the day, and I would say, did I talk to everyone today? Oh my God, I didn't talk to Anthony today. Like, I said nothing to Anthony today. Isn't that sad? Like, that really depresses me, because can you imagine sitting in a classroom all day long and you weren't talked to by your teacher because you're busy? Where are you? You're busy up front. You're busy teaching. I have things to do. No. You're missing it. You're not using your FaceTime appropriately. Anthony deserves for you not only to talk to him, but sit down next to him and listen to him. That's so important. When you build HyperDocs, you don't have to lecture. You give the kids the work, and where are you? You're with the kids. You're doing it with them. You're not checking your email, and you're not grading your papers. I'm sorry, don't do it. Resist. Because you get the energy for the craft that you love by being with those kids. You know it. That's like the best part. Don't you always say that? It's all about the kids. So be with them, study them, and then keep creating these to get to what your kids need. That's where the assessment is. I wish that testing companies would come in and talk to me about that part of assessment. I'll tell you some assessment on that child. I could tell you everything you want to know. Do you have time to listen? Because my fill in the bubble is not going to give you the answers you're looking for. I know way more than that. I'm sorry. I'm going to step off that soapbox. I'm getting a little preachy. All right, I'm done. I'm totally done. I was getting fired up. I just feel so strongly about this. Okay, whew. Let's have some fun. Okay, so when I... I'm so embarrassed. I just get in my head, and that's why we had to write the book. when I want to do group work, and it's really hard to manage 11 teams, just link them all up in a table and say, get to work. And those are each individual maps on their own road trip across the United States. No more standing up and memorizing the 50 states. Here's one of my favorites, and this goes for every grade level. It's the Show What You Know challenge, and I have about 6 different versions of this that I just keep recreating and reiterating and rethinking about. And when I'm at the end of a topic and I don't know what to do for the apply, I just go to this link. Just show me what you know. It's such a good cop-out, you know? And actually, they love it. And I change the tools all the time. These are ones that I have been working on, that we've been building up to and knowing. And yet, you know, this is where flipped teaching, this is my kind of flipped teaching. I put my video tutorials or wherever I can find on YouTube, I put them right underneath the web tool. So I don't know how to use Powtoon still to this day. I love Powtoon. My kids make great Powtoons. I have no idea how to do it because I haven't taken the time to do it. I don't need to know all of these. I mean, it's fine if they can just go on there and say, hey, I want to learn it myself. It saves you so much. You don't have to listen to 180 PowerPoint presentations. That alone is reason to give this. Now, the best part is let them turn their work in here. This is a Google form. And let them look at each other's projects. Give them the link to the response sheet. I could see everyone's projects. Why not? They're very motivated. And you know what? An authentic audience is built in right away because they know that somebody else is going to see this. They know their classmates are going to see this. And sometimes they'll go in and see a classmate and they'll be like, oh, you mean you could do that? You mean you could be creative and put effort in? Oh, and they go back and they fix theirs. They're like, can I put mine back in again? I'm like, oh, really? You wanted to revise and do better? Now, I have to escape for a moment and go to my website. Because on my website, I have to share, some other HyperDocs. Oh, come on. There we go. So this is the HyperDoc website. It's such a mess, but bear with me. And they're all down the sides are all these HyperDocs, and I'm going straight down here on this side. These are HyperDocs that when we started talking about this, we started to tweet about it and share them on Twitter, and some teachers really started talking to us about it. And we started talking back about it, and they just took the concept, and they took it to a whole new level that we hadn't thought about. These are middle school teachers that that I worked with. Rocky, who's in the audience, is one that has completely changed my thinking about this because it was from the perspective of the students that he was working with. And he was trying to, and I have your West African kingdoms up, he was trying to engage kids with text and get through content and build in what he calls slide books. And I love these. I'm crazy about them. And so as you go through, kids are looking and exploring the content. And then he has their instructions as they go through each slide. See, we see slides not as presentations anymore. I hope you do too. They're books. The kids can turn the pages. Each piece of the lesson can be on a different slide. He actually built these text boxes in here where kids would work on the slide. It's not, you know, usually you're like, I'm going to show the slides. No, this is a little different. This is where kids would actually take the slide and make a copy and put their work right on the slide deck where the information was. Like, oh, of course, brilliant. Why wouldn't I do this? And you can make it collaborative. Kids could do it together. And he has all these different iterations of this. And then he gets to the big idea and the essential questions. And then he goes to the form to fill out and share their thinking. Now, on many of Rocky's he has, and I've got them all over the place, actually, he has activities for them to do and links for them to create with. And they launch, and they just keep going places more and more. Matt McFarlane is another person who's been creating these slide books. The same idea. Imagine if you took your boring text and you added just video to it. Like, didn't you always wish there was just video next to the little, you know, text piece that's this big? It doesn't have nearly enough. And how engaging your text would be if you could curate it like this and create and add to it. It's incredible text. Heather, who is a middle school English teacher, she has created these amazing slide books that go through and guide kids through big concepts, about Ivan. And it's really in depth what you could put on a slide. And instead of you showing it, you give it to the kids. You just build it out for them there. And she's used this model for two other ones as well. She's used it for the Edgar Allan Poe unit and for the Jabberwocky. And I have so many more. My own science teachers in our district, she took her science packet and she thinks of it. She changed the size. Actually, Rocky, you inspired this teacher. Instead of seeing your slides, horizontal, just turn it vertical and it looks like it's sort of like your packet you would hand out. And the link is that staple, right? And let the kids work straight from here. And so this was her whole unit on chemical reactions. And the kids collaboratively, one Chromebook per desk, worked through this lab. And there's a lot of content. And there's links all over this. And she was able to get on here and see what kind of work that they were doing and give them instruction. And some days she was like, stop, we're doing this one together. And I think it's amazing how, and I hope Rocky sees this, the influence he's had on this teacher. Because he was willing to share his work on Twitter, like you cannot believe he shares everything. Other teachers are now seeing that work and saying, I can do that too. I can make that. I just didn't think of it like that. And now you can do that as well. It's really powerful, the amount of sharing that can happen. So why do kids need HyperDocs? I know I've said it already. I'm not going to speech. Don't worry, it's not going to be a speech. I want you to think back to your favorite teacher you ever had. And I want you to just be quiet right now and just think about that person. Picture him in your mind. And I want you to think about, what was it? Why were they your favorite? What do you remember about them? I remember my favorite teacher. You know what? Can we do, on the count of three, I just want you to call their name out as loud as you can. One, two, three. Mrs. Maloney! Okay, do you see their names floating above us? I have this thing with words, like I can see. They're like here with us right now. Isn't that pretty cool? Mrs. Maloney is my favorite teacher because she cared about me. I don't remember what test she gave me. I don't remember what grade I got. She noticed me. She got me. I was not an easy kid to get, let me tell you. Nobody understood me. I had my own idea about what I should be doing at school. Kids just want you to connect with them. They just want to be heard. They just want to be understood. And if you're in front of the classroom, it's a little hard to do that. I'm not going to go there again. You know what how I feel about that. But they really do want that. And to be honest, you do too, because that's what gives you the energy to teach. That's what makes getting up every morning the most exciting thing. Because then this is what you get. This is what you have. Creating kids. They're not falling asleep sitting in their desk. They're not turning in stacks of papers. You're getting things like these. You're getting faces like that. You're getting movement. You're getting activities that you never thought you could get because you were only giving them requirements, and they're only going to work up to the level of the requirement you asked for. Why not just open it up and say, show me what you can do, and teach them what that looks like, and you nudge them and make them give you the best quality work that they can give you. It starts this whole cycle, this whole new way of school, where once kids are engaged, you can educate them and you can inspire them. And when they're inspired, they're like, ooh, I'm curious now. I wonder. And then they're engaged and it starts again. And it starts this whole cycle of learning that is so powerful. And I really thought that this was all about the kids when I first used to talk about the engage, educate, inspire cycle. Because this was my goal in the classroom. I'm like, I'm going to hook you, I'm going to teach you, and then you're going to be inspired. And then guess what happened? It happened to me. Oh my gosh, it happened to me. I'm like, I've been teaching 23 years. And I love this. I'm engaged. I care. I care. I can't wait to see what they're going to do. I just want to create for them. And then I want to educate them. And then I want to inspire them. And I can't wait to see their faces. And I can't wait to listen to their inspiration. And I want to hook them again and keep it going. And then I want to stand back. I want to stand back and just watch it happen, watch them take off with it. Why do teachers, my teachers need HyperDocs? Well, I can't say I ever was the Norman Rockwell teacher. I always have been kind of a free-range teacher. But I did make my students sit in their desks all the time for long periods of time. And really, I needed them to be doing this because they were passive learners. And I need them to be active learners. I need them doing the work. I'm working way too hard. So now my plate is shared. Are you starting to see how my plate looks different? It's not piles. It's all kind of meshed together. We all share in this. They take on a lot of the load. And I get back to the most important part of instruction, the craft that I loved the most. And whenever I think of creating awesome lessons, I think of nesting dolls. There are so many layers to learning and so many layers to good instruction and things that you can add in. That's that big mantra again, that big poster in the beginning. How much more can we add in? You can. Look, this is how you do it. It all fits nice and neat all together. It is possible. And once you add a new layer, try adding another layer when you're ready. And then try slipping in another layer, like soft skills, you know, and like getting along. And don't make them separate. Make it together. It should be together all at once. That is a real power in your instruction. And here comes my favorite, aside from HyperDocs, my favorite project. And this started one night when a teacher that I coach emailed me and said, I need some help with the unit, I can't find anything. And I went to my team and they don't have anything to share. And I said, sure, I'll do that. And then she emails me later, oh no, don't worry, I went to Teachers Pay Teachers and I found something. And she shared it with me. And I looked. And she didn't notice who sold that to her. It was a teacher on her team. I was sick. And that night, I created Teachers Give Teachers on Twitter. That should not happen. That takes away all your energy at school. That makes you hide in your classrooms, and I know you do that. You're like, I'm not gonna do anything out. It makes me stand out because I gotta hide because you know that all that. Mm-mm. If you are feeling that at school, please join us. We're here. Like, I'm sounding like a cult. It's not. That was awful. I even changed that. No, just go on and just look. And like I can see the top of Rocky's head on there. People are tweeting to Teachers Give Teachers, and they are tweeting their HyperDocs. You cannot believe the content they're putting out there. And I forgot to say this all along, but if you liked any of those HyperDocs that you saw today, it's a Google Doc. You go to File and make a copy, and it's yours. You can have it. You're like, what? It's like Oprah. It's my Oprah moment. HyperDoc for you, HyperDoc for you, HyperDoc for you. Woo! I'm serious. If you ever come across a digital lesson, and I don't even care what you call it, just go to File, make a copy. If you like just the structure of it or the look of it, but you don't even teach that subject, just delete all the content and use the structure. I love to see old HyperDocs that I have done in a whole new way, a whole new look. I just ask it, why don't you share it back? Go to Teachers Give Teachers and share the link. And don't say, oh, my stuff isn't good enough to put out there yet. What are we waiting for? It's not like we're gonna judge it and go, oh, did you see that HyperDoc in the Twitter stream? We're not. We're gonna be all excited. You know, maybe you're gonna add a new flavor, a new twist, a new design to it, a new appeal that we haven't seen. Now, I'm really excited because Carly Mora is here today with us. And Carly, who's up front, thank you. Carly is like the HyperDoc PR agent. And if you know Carly on Twitter, she tweets about HyperDocs, and thank goodness, because you get the word out, and she's working with DitchBook now, and now they're tweeting about it, and all of these Tosa chats are tweeting about it. And Carly, I can't thank you enough for this, that you have gotten the word out. Let's give her a big hand. But she can't do this alone. And she's been working and there's many of you. I know, Judy, thank you so much. You have been bringing that philosophy back in. And people are just, there's so many people. I could go on and on about it. Will, you've been spreading the word. You've been presenting about it. I mean, I could just keep going and going with the people who have been bringing new ideas and thoughts to the idea behind HyperDocs. And we're doing it here on Teachers Give Teachers right now on Twitter. And tagging things this way. And if you just keep going through the stream, add to that conversation. I think that the more people that hear about it and have the conversation and you can share what you're doing, the more powerful it is. It makes you so you're not an island in your job anymore. And that also brings an element of this energy to what you're doing. And you feel like, I don't have to make all these all the time. Oh, I didn't also mention that. You don't have to make these every day. You're like, really? Oh God, thank goodness. Maybe just make one for the end of the school year and see how it works. Maybe then you might make, just look at one unit that is like so boring to you and you just want to snazz it up a little bit. Just HyperDoc one thing, try it out. Maybe then get to one a month, you know, and maybe one a week. And don't overload yourself. This isn't something that I used all day, every day. Oh, never. I don't have one-to-one devices. This is not a curriculum replacement. This would be like, oh, just for that history unit I was using it for. This is not the bulk of my day. So I hope that put it a little bit into perspective. This is not all day, every day, kids working off of a HyperDoc. No, and you're like, oh, what a relief. Like, how am I gonna go home and make all these? No, make one, have some fun with it. Make a fun one to begin with too, forget that content. Oh my God, I almost. Fadigi's in the house. Are there administrators in the room? So, I'm not leaving you out. As she's leaving, that was Amy Fadigi, principal, youngest principal in California. HyperDocs are for principals also, and I'll tell you why. And they're for district administration, they're for the superintendent, they're for the assistant superintendent. Because principals, teachers are your students. How are you maximizing FaceTime with them? Maybe you need to HyperDoc your faculty meeting. Instead of showing the slides of data on the screen, this makes me so crazy, give the teachers the slides with the data and let them go through it with an expectation of, show me what you're curious about. Do you love that idea? And then have that FaceTime discussion. What did you notice? What are patterns and trends in our data? I'm like, oh my God, I actually had to look at it. Because I was looking at my email when you were presenting that PowerPoint with 80 slides of data. Get to the heart of your building community with your staff, with doing some of these activities with HyperDocs. It can be really, really important. All right, I totally blew the reveal. And I've been talking about it, so it's okay. We wrote a book. And it's not a long book. It feels shorter than this whole talk. I feel like I've been up here for like 3 hours. I'm so sorry to do that to you. But it's a handbook, and we called it a handbook because it walks you through how to make these. It walks you through the pedagogy and how important that is to us. It has templates and rubrics and examples, over 100 examples in here. I think this is powerful. I think every teacher who gets a Chromebook should get the HyperDoc handbook to go with it. Don't you think? You can get on the pre-order list on bit.ly/order HyperDocs. And it's just a list that we're just keeping track of, and the first people on there are gonna get the first one. So, ladies and gentlemen, I really appreciate you listening to all of this and to my preaching. I apologize too much, but it has been wonderful to share the love of HyperDocs with you. Thank you.